Are you ready, mundanes?
Ho!
Who lives in an institute up in New York?
Shadow Hunters!
Gorgeous in leather and pop culture-y!
Shadow Hunters!
There's plot holes and nonsense, but what can we say?
Shadow Hunters!
We're hoping the writing gets better, okay?
Shadow Hunters!
Shadow Hunters! Shadow Hunters! Shadow Hunters! Shadow Hunters!
Episode of season one. It's been a crazy 13 weeks. So this episode was called Morningstar, and I'm so happy to say that I enjoyed it. I think it's definitely one of their best episodes of the season. I know I've said a million times my favorite episode is episode 5, and I still think that was the funniest episode. This episode, I think, made a lot of sense, and it flowed super nice, and it had some nice fight scenes. It had very little cheesy dialogue, and I was just very happy with it in terms of looking at the season as a whole. I think it's up there with episode number 5. 13, 5, 7, 10, 8. Everything else falls in the middle, and then episode 3 at the bottom, I think, is how I would rate it. I'd give this episode a B, B plus. It was a good episode. As always, there are little things, of course, that I'm gonna have issues with, and I'm going to look at these little things because I'm here to review the show. That's what I do. If you don't want to hear an opinion that may be different from yours, please click away now. I've said it a million times. I want this show to succeed. I want it to get better. I'm a giant fan of this book series. I really care about this story. If I'm critical in a review, it in no way negates that sentiment. Moving on. Okay, let's talk about this episode. That's the end of my non-spoilery section of this video. If you haven't seen the episode and you don't want to be spoiled, you can leave now, okay? Bye! Valentine's boat is in this episode for the first time, and it is beautiful. The first shot that we see the boat in, I was sitting there fangirling like, oh my god, it's a real boat. It looks real. It's beautiful. And they're on it. It made the cinematography look so nice to have this real boat, not feel like we were on a set at all. It was real! That shot in the morning when Jace walks out and he's looking for Valentine and he's at the dock and the city's in the background and the water's there and there's another boat. Oh my god, it looked beautiful. The aesthetic, gorgeous. Jace in this episode, Jace is progressively just feeling more like Jace as we go along. Not humorous Jace, but angsty Jace is totally there now. I've been really getting the Jace vibes. We get the best fight scene I think we've gotten all season here with Hodge versus Jace, because the other fight scene that was really good that we got was Jace versus Alec, and that just made no sense to me. It just can't compute. But this fight was awesome. They were flipping backwards and forwards, and there was even a little bit of that fast forward effect, but I didn't even care because it was choreographed really nicely and it looked awesome and it looked like they were fighting and they were going at it, and Dom was kicking ass and Hodge was being Hodge. It was glorious.
I taught you everything I know.
Not everything. Fwah, fwah. Whips out giant two-sided lightsaber. This scene was very Star Wars. I've never seen a double-edged Seraph blade. But you can't deny it looked cool. Like, that was a quality fight scene. And Jace saws off his hand at the end. Also, so Star Wars. I'm really happy that we captured Hodge and we saw that happen, foiling this fantastic kick-ass fight scene that I think was the highlight of this episode. We had the end non-fight scene, which was the biggest issue I had with this episode, that at the end, when all Valentine's guys came, everyone was very easily subdued and held by one of Valentine's thugs. It was kind of like in the Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix film, when in the Hall of Mysteries, our gang is in the room with the veil and the Death Eaters have them cornered and they've all got them with a wand to their neck and there's nothing they can do, right? But before that, there was a shootout, a wand shootout with all the prophecies around. They put up a fight. There was a struggle. I just think everyone went down too easy in this scene. I mean, Magnus was held at Seraphblade point. I mean, come on. You know, I think that scene had the potential to be so cool if we saw everyone fighting. And Valentine could overpower them in the end, but I feel like there should have been a section where they did go at it. Simon was like, no! They knocked him down really easily. Izzy was like, Simon! She whipped and they just knocked her right down. I mean, Izzy! That's Izzy! She gets right back up when she gets knocked down. She does not take no for an answer. She does not take knocked down for an answer. That might have come down to, you know, stunt choreography and how much time and effort that takes for with a scene with so many people, and they just didn't want to do it, but...
Oh, it would have been glorious. I mean, we just watched Jace completely take down Hodge.
You set a standard for yourself, and then there was just, it was an anticlimactic scene there.
I love seeing Izzy use her whip again in this episode. I always want to see more, though. We always get these close-up shots, and it goes so quickly. We don't get, like, a full-blown aerial Izzy fighting shot.
I keep thinking back to the scene in the City of Bones movie where they're at Hotel du Mont, and it's so awesome. Like, that's the best scene in the film for me. Everyone's fighting tooth and nail, and Simon and Claire, you're like hiding under the table, and there's like some humorous moments with Jace, and it's so good.
It was so satisfying to see Jace chop off his hand there. I was just like, I've been waiting for this Jace. This Jace is Jace.
I was really happy to see Izzy more involved again. I feel like we haven't really seen her fight to the extent that we know Izzy can fight. Like, I want to see Izzy in a fight like Jason Hodge. We see her with the whip whipping around, but Izzy is physical. Like, she uses the whip and her body to fight. She kicks ass.
Like, the fact that Raph just zoomed away and she let him zoom away just felt so un-Izzy. Like, if you've read the books, you know that she would have been on his ass in 5 seconds.
Magnus in this episode was very Jack Sparrow, and I'm a huge fan of Jack Sparrow, so I enjoyed this. I mean, it's not the Magnus, like, I've said this a lot, it's not the Magnus from the book, but Harry Shum TV Magnus was very Jack Sparrow in this episode, and I enjoyed it. Camille shows up, and she just kisses Magnus out of the blue. Maybe she hears Alec coming. When they turn and look at Alec, Magnus is like, I loved that. And there's this moment where he kind of like shoos everyone, and it just, it's so Jack Sparrow.
I really liked the conversation between Magnus and Alec about his mortality. It felt really genuine. It felt really in character. It looks like they are gonna push Alec the way that he goes in the book.
I had a huge number of people angry at me for saying they felt like insta-love last week, but my entire review, I'm talking about Magnus and how he's saying things that are alluding to the fact that he thinks he's in love. In this episode, it comes up again. Camille's like, oh, you think you've already found love? And Magnus is just like, Like, to clarify, if you didn't get that, I was referring to Magnus, not Alec, who said, this isn't love, 5 seconds after that scene. I mean, I'm aware, I watched the episode. Not just pulling it out of my ass. I'm finding it very amusing that since Simon has turned into a vampire, he's little by little became Raphael's twin. Like, they're doing their hair the same way, they're dressing the same way.
So Valentine unveils his whole plan with the cup in this episode. He wants to form an army of Shadowhunters because there's not enough Shadowhunters and he doesn't care who dies in the process, there needs to be more. He gets the cup. It was weird to me, and I guess this isn't a thing in the show, but that the first guy was clearly like middle-aged-ish, and he's the first one to take the sip from the mortal cup, and he doesn't die. I thought that guy was for sure a goner, but he just like pops right back up. I'm a shadow hunter now.
Here's your Seraph blade. I have 50,000 more in this box next to me.
You know what scene I thought was great? When Hodge appeared on the boat to Valentine, and he's like, wait, Jason Clary, why do you need Jason Clary? And Valentine's like, oh, you, why are you still here, you traitor? And Hodge kind of pleads his case. Have I not shown my loyalty? And Valentine just shoos him away, like he's done with it. It was nice to see that kind of emotion in Hodge and see him kind of backpedal on his decision a little bit.
We have a whole load of Camille in this episode. Camille's character in the show is very different from her in the book, at least in my perspective. Her in the book is a lot more refined and older feeling. This Camille kind of has like teenager-y feeling to her mannerisms and the things she says. She feels sassy in a younger way than Camille in the books, who feels like a queen, like a legit badass bitch who's really intelligent. Like, this Camille feels like she knows things, but she doesn't feel as smart. Anyone else agree with me on that? It's like a kind of a different dynamic. I wouldn't believe as much that Magnus was with this Camille. She has the Book of White in her house. Jocelyn hid it there. She wants Simon to pardon her for killing him in exchange for the Book of White. They get to her apartment, it's like a mansion. She has this huge, beautiful library room. Simon goes and signs the thing before she's even taken the book out. I was like, why are you signing this? You're in the apartment full of books. Get her to get the book before you sign it, and then you can do a little tradey trade. I mean, Simon can't take the book away from you. You're stronger than everyone. But no, Simon just signs it. I'm like, oh, rookie, why would you do that? You've come this far. When Camille reveals she doesn't know where the book is, and she has 3 full library rooms. So you guys
Have fun. I'm expecting them to start, like, tearing books down. I just feel like they kind of rushed this last scene. Like, it had potential to be really cool, but they kind of rushed it. I'm not saying it was bad. I'm saying, like, it was lacking the luster that it could have had. If she was running around throwing books around, it would have been a beautiful visual. It would have made sense, because that's what I would have been doing. I would have been, like, opening books, chucking them everywhere. But they were just kind of, like, looking at their spines. Guys, come on! Before long, Clary just happens to find the cookbook. She's seen her mom use it for chicken cacciatore, you know. Okay. And then Valentine shows up. I'm pretty sure in City of Ashes, Jace eventually goes to the boat to see his dad, right? Or he does go a few times. Or they're doing something City of Ashes-y with this. It's going in the same direction. Jace goes with his dad. Clary is really, really upset. And seeing her that upset actually, like, arose some emotion in me. I almost got to the point where I almost was tearing up, but I didn't. And Clary and Simon are gonna find him. And I think that's gonna hopefully go just like it goes in City of Ashes with that awesome boat scene. There's this awesome fight scene, and Clary, like, explodes the boat with the ruins, and it's so cool. Really hope that's in there. We end with this giant, really nice, craning away boat shot that looked great. Valentine's like, join me and my son! And Jace is just there, like, dad dragged me to work. Dad dragged me to work. He wants me to follow in his footsteps, and I just want to do my own thing. It was a good episode. I'm really looking forward to seeing what they do with season two. Thanks for sticking with me and talking about the show every week. I'm Christine. I'll talk to you next time. Thanks for watching. Bye.